Turn to hymn number 11 now. Come thou fount of every blessing. Certainly we are blessed that we've made it here.
Amen.
We were able to get out of our respective driveways and roadways and make it here to hear that beautiful music.
Amen. We're doing all the verses.
Hymn number 11, all three verses.
I'll change the key then.
Okay.
Praise the Lord, because he's still on the throne in his hand. He's in control of all things. We have much to be thankful for. We praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. And we will cancel church tonight, so we can spend a day shoveling out our driveways and whatever else we got to shovel. But we praise the Lord for us being here. If you notice, February prayer points are available. There, in the prayer calendar, praying for the mission and the missionaries. So I'll be reading from John chapter 4, verses 11 to 26, and it's about the woman at the well. And the conversation with Jesus. And the woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself as well, and his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water, springing up into everlasting life. The woman said to him, Sir, give me this water that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw. And Jesus said to her, Go, call your husband, and come here. And the woman answered and said, I have no husband. And Jesus said to her, You have well said, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that you spoke truly. And the woman said to him, Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worship on this mountain, and you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where you ought to worship. And Jesus said to her, Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know that we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. Amen. The woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. And Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Amen. Before we go to the Lord in prayer, I just want to share, I'll call about 10:45. And he plans on coming back Tuesday, hopefully, but he said his son, they're going to give him chemo tomorrow, but just to give him hope. He said it spread so much that the doctor said he might have just a month to live. Charles, so I want us to pray for Charles, and I'm going to pray for the Lord. And dealing with his weight that he has on him, you see his son. And so, remember, I'll be coming back Tuesday, or whenever he comes back, whatever day, but the weight upon him and his journey, that it'll be safe and journey, and just pray for the Lord healing. Unless God intervenes, that's not much time. Let us bow our heads as we come before Almighty God. Our Lord, our Savior, our God, we enter your gates with thanksgiving. We come before you with praise. And as you have all gotten us here this morning into this place, we thank you and we praise you. And as we lift up your name, Lord Father, we have no other name. We have no other God. We have no other one where salvation comes from. And Lord, you sit on your throne. And as we come before you, we acknowledge all of us and our brothers and sisters that aren't here this morning, as hopefully they're praying this morning and coming before you, that we pray, Lord Father, for our brother Earl and Charles, the weight that he has. We pray for the perseverance, the spiritual strength and guidance, and the comfort he needs from your Holy Spirit. We pray for Earl, our love for him and our prayers for him and for his family. And we lift up Charles, Lord Father, all to the throne of grace, Lord, for not only healing your hand to heal, you do know you can do it, Lord. We trust you, we look to you, and we pray for your hand not only to heal, but to give strength and to minister to Charles, Lord Father. Put your healing hand upon him and minister to him in a way, Lord Father, that you alone will get the praise, the glory, and the honor. Oh, Lord, put your healing hand upon him today, Lord. Minister to him as only you can. We pray for our brothers and sisters who aren't here, safety of their home, that you help them to enjoy this Lord today in their household, that they will worship you in spirit and truth. And all of us here this morning, that our hearts, and we do have prayer requests, and there are others, and we lift them up in prayer, but to know, Lord Father, you have blessed us, you've watched over us, you've got us here. And as we leave this place, we know that you'll watch over us and guide us, and let your Holy Spirit just be poured out upon all of us this morning, that the joy of the Lord will be our strength. Joy of the Lord will guide us and direct us. In Jesus Christ we pray and ask these things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's worship now with hymn number 214.
Thank you.
441. Disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appeared to them.
When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted.
And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying,
All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world.
Say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest.
But what saith he? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach.
That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God raise him from the dead, thou shalt be saved.
For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness,
and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
For the scripture saith, Whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed.
For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
How then shall they call on him in whom they may not believe?
And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written,
How beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things.
Amen. Let's remain standing for our offertory hymn. It's number 410. We'll sing the first, second, fifth verses.
What number again?
410.
Thank you.
No, you're doing great.
Yes, you are. All three?
Yes.
Refrain each time.
Yes.
Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And Sister Lois, some of us have to have a confession, because when you were playing Standing on the Promises, and when you danced at 1, 2, and 5, he says, "Do you want to do the special one on the fifth verse?" And he said, "Yeah." And he said, "I hope you remember." I said, "Lord, help her remember." But me and a couple people on this side, when we got to verse 5, we just started singing. So we jumped the gun. We had forgotten, because I'm not naming any other cohorts. That's what caused you the problem. There were, some of us were singing while you were just getting ready to do the fancy part, the verse. So, some of us forgot. See that, brother? So I was trying to help you remember, and I forgot myself.
We got to work together.
So, I was just in tune, just, you know, just when the fifth verse came, I started it. Amen. It is good to be among friends, is it not? Friends in the Lord. Amen. We love one another. Starting with verse 19 to 27, it's 9 verses. And Paul has 2 thoughts in the rest of chapter 9. "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all." That's hard to do. "That I might win the more. And to the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, not being without law toward God, but under law towards Christ." He's talking about those of us who believe. "That I might win those who are without law. To the weak I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I have became all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may obtain it. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Therefore I run this, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified." You notice in the rest of chapter 9, Paul's basically talking about 2 things. He's talking about his relationship to all the people, to lost people, basically, and to Christians. But his relationship to people. And then the second thing he talks about is being disciplined. His personal discipline that he had. That's really an example to all of us, and an example that we should imitate. As he says in chapter 11, verse 1. And Paul's saying that, remember, and these people now are having problems just doing the basic things of Christianity. And that's why I'm telling you, for the sake of the gospel, that's why Paul, becoming a slave to all. And I want you to think about that. Man, it's hard enough to become slave to our brothers and sisters. But to become slave to all people, talk about lost. To the lost Jew, to the lost Gentile, to the lost Greek, or to the agnostic thinker, to the Muslim, anybody. To be their servant. That's what Paul is inclining them and trying to teach them about becoming a slave. First to the Jews. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 22, Paul, he talks about his Jewish heritage. He says, are they Hebrews? And he says, I am also. Are they Israelites? I am also. Yeah. Are they the seed of Abraham? I am also. 2 Corinthians 11:22. And what he's trying to, there are Jews in the congregation, probably some saved and some not, but some who were holding, and this is what happens, people, because, and it happens in church where people have been in the church, Sunday school teacher 30 years, but they don't know the Lord. And just like some of these Jews, because of their heritage, well, I'm a Jew, I'm of the covenant. And in their relationship. And they even know the Bible, the Old Testament scripture, but what happens is they don't know the Lord. So Paul is addressing these people, and to, as himself, to the Jews. He became a servant to the Jews. tries to minister to these people, these Jewish lost people especially, about what it means to become a Christian, what it means to be saved, what it means. If you remember, he circumcised Timothy. He even self, the book of Acts says he made a Nazarene vow. Paul did, for a short time. Remember, whenever Paul preached, whenever he went into a new town, the first place he looked for was the synagogue. He was the apostle to the Jews and to the Gentiles, but he had Jewish connections, so what happened? He used those for the sake of the gospel. He did try to get the Jews mad on purpose. What he did was he tried to minister to them to the gospel. And we need to remember that, what Paul was doing. Second group he talks about is to the Gentiles. Now remember, in the church there were people, and I'm going to just say some Christians and some lost, that there were people there, Gentiles, that thought that a free man can do anything he wants. Remember? Yeah. And he can eat any kind of meat, he can have it, he can have sex with anybody.
Yeah.
That was one of the problems. They thought they could do anything. So he's dealing with some people like that, some philosophers, some Stoics, and a number of other things. So he's dealing with Gentiles that have, I want you to think, have that attitude. And remember, they were viewing teachers as special, especially if you can make money as a teacher and be a prophetic speaker. Paul's trying to tell them he's not a kingpin. Have you ever seen that movie, King Ram? It's about the World War II POW, where the one guy becomes king. He starts buying and selling things. Takes Red Cross packages and he becomes a king in the POW. It's rather an interesting movie. It's an old one. But that's not Paul. Paul's a servant to all, to the Jew, to the Gentile. Because those Gentiles that do not know Jesus, they need to come to them, and he's willing to do this. Be a servant to the Jew, to the Gentiles. And the third group, he says there, to the weak. In verse 22, to the weak I became as weak that I might win the weak. And I'm going to translate that. Look over in chapter 10, verse 32. Because toward the end of chapter 10, and remember 8, 9, and 10, he's dealing with food, meat. He says, give no offense either to the Jews, and that's who he's going to minister to for the sake of the gospel, to the Greeks for the sake of the gospel, or to the church of God. And I'm reading back into this here and taking this in chapter 9 here and dealing with the church of God. Every church, there are lost people and saints in it.
Amen.
There are weak people that are lost and weak people that are Christians.
Yeah.
And that whoever they are, whatever, just like people in the church, they're just thinking about becoming Christians. Or some may have decided to become Christians and take that step of faith, take that initial step, and they're not sure what it all encompasses. And Paul says, you need to be careful of those people, to the church of God. So I'm reading that into chapter 9 there, to the weak. They could be lost, they could be saved, they could be young Christians, new Christians, or people trying to decide. And you need to be careful in your relationship with these people. You need to be a servant to all these people, to the Jews, to the Gentiles, to the weak. You need to be a servant to all. I tell you what, that's hard, to be a servant. It's hard being a servant to brothers and sisters, but God expects you to the weak and to those in church. And in verse 23, I apply this to Christ. He says, now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you. And I'm going to relate it to three verses. To this verse is the middle verse. But in chapter 8, verse 1, and when he starts this section, he's talking to brothers and sisters for love. Love edifies. So you have to be one, become a servant to the brothers and sisters, to all of them. Not most of them, not the ones you handpick, but to all of them. And then in chapter 9, verse 23, he's talking about lost people for the sake of the gospel. You have to become a servant to all of them. And then thirdly, look at chapter 10 again, verse 31. But if I partake with thanks, verse 31, therefore whatever you eat or drink, God. And it's for the purpose of doing, bringing glory and honor to God. I'm going to be a servant to the Jew, to the Gentile, to the weak. I'm going to love my brothers and sisters for the glory of God. The people in Corinth, most of them, not all of them, they have made a disconnect between their personal salvation and for the sake of the gospel, loving others. Remember, that's why Paul's addressing this. Because there were some looking down, well, because, and people do that in church, whether they're vegetarian or they eat meat, do whatever they want to. Well, I can do whatever I want to. Paul says you can't have that attitude. Especially to your brothers and sisters, to the lost Jew, Gentile, or the weak. It is for the glory of God. All these three are connected together. To the love of the brethren, for the sake of the gospel, for the glory of God. And some have made no connection at all. And Paul's addressing that. We do all these things for the glory of God. If it will help my brother and sister, I will not eat meat. And we need to be ready in the back of our mind as a servant to all. And people don't like being a servant. And remember in Corinth, they thought being a Christian, being a speaker, you were top dog. It means being a servant to all. And that's hard. Because we know our place. I've been here 30 years. I'm just using that. I've only been here 20 years. But people get that union mentality, 30 or 35, 40, I've been here the longest. And I should do this. I should be able to that. And what happens is Christianity doesn't work that way. You do it, first of all, for the glory of God. Notice Paul puts that last because they're having trouble in 8:1 doing that, loving your brothers, let alone for the sake of the gospel, the lost Jew, the lost Gentile, the lost weak person, and then for the glory of God. All three of those are connected. And people make a disconnect. Now, I see it today. People don't make the connection, and Paul's trying to, and you've got to become a slave. And that's what Paul is doing. And my second point, in verses 24 to 27, he says, running to win. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Remember, in these times, they didn't have a bronze or a silver medal. They only had a pine laurel. And then as I was reading up on these games, the Isthmian Games was held in Corinth. But a number of other Greek cities had other games too. Every second year, and then the fourth year would be the Olympic Games. And they would actually, they got so cheap that they would make crowns out of celery and give it to the winner. And as I was reading up on some of these games, sometimes when the winner got his celery wreath, it was wilted away. You couldn't even eat it. And then even beyond that, they went from celery to parsley. Getting a parsley crown, you think, wow. And because he's going to talk about that, man, we run for the incorruptible crown. That's what we run for. Now remember yesterday, I hope you saw the news, there was the punch key race in Hamtramck. Yeah. Paul's not talking about that kind of race. Because the punch key race is 6K. After the end of the trial, because he's going to talk about being disciplined here. They got punch keys and beer. Free punch keys and beers. There were people holding up punch keys and beer. Beers in both hands yesterday. Paul's not talking about a race like that. Even though he is talking about the race, running the race spiritually and physically, but not so that you can eat punch keys and drink beer. Because you have to be disciplined in what you take in dealing with the body. So you run to win in those games, and he's talking about persevering and discipline. Without both of those, you're not going to be able to win. You're not going to be able to be a servant to all your brothers and sisters. You're not going to be able to be a servant. Sing this. You're not going to be a servant to the lost Jews, to the lost Gentiles, and to the lost weak. Because you have failed in running the race the way you should. Now I want you to think about that. A lot of times we, well, this applies to ourselves. It does, but for the glory of God. And David, don't leave church with that battery, okay? The clock says 10:30. I guess I got an hour and a half and I can still preach, okay? All right? I gave him the battery from the clock. He forgot. Brother Carl, you and I are in good company.
All right.
Sorry, dear. and run in such a way as you obtain it. You got to be disciplined. And in fact, I know last Olympics, they were talking to some, I'm talking about the one in 2014, they were talking to some of the skaters, and do you know they practice 8 hours every day? What do you think about that? I mean, there are things I love, softball and bowling. I couldn't do those 8 hours a day. But they do it every day. Only occasionally when there's something in the schedule that happens, do they ever take a break. Just think, they practice 8 to 12 hours a day. And some days, I'm sitting there, I know how they do it. But that's how they get the gold medal. And practice, being disciplined. And discipline, as we'll see here, and as we'll see next week in chapter 10, it deals with what you eat, what you drink, how you sleep, where you go, what you do, spiritually and physically, as we will say. And it deals with, I put in there, self-control, because that's what he talks about. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate, or self-control. And self-control is a fruit of the Spirit. Athletes who want to win the gold, they don't act like they're going to do the punch key race. Because they are very, in fact, they all have their own drinks. Talking about protein in their water. They know what each individual takes. It's not the same water, the same mixture. As you listen, they all have a certain mixture for themselves because of their body. And each one of us are different, just like they are. And they all have the drink. They have their bottles and names on it. And it's a special drink just made up for them, for their body. And that's about what he's talking about here. Having self-control over those things. What does he say? In all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Just think, they do this for something. Just how much they parsley and celery and wood. They went all out for that. How much more should we go all out for an imperishable crown? Of leading Jews, Gentiles, or weak people to the Lord, sharing the good news, sharing the gospel. That's what he's talking about here. Being a servant to them. And not pointing the finger at them. Well, as Paul is saying that. And I put in there spiritual flabby, because that's what happened to the saints in Corinth. They're not even thinking about their brothers and sisters. They're not even thinking about the Jews or the Gentiles or the weak Christians. They're thinking about themselves. A lot of people in the church do that. What's in it for me? It's for the glory of God. And what happens is, when you get short-sighted like that, and the saints in Corinth, they were definitely getting shabby. Physically and spiritually. Just think, they couldn't even love one another. How are you going to love lost people? And Paul's addressing that. Spiritual flat. And I included in here what building materials, because in the last two verses, he talks about, therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty, thus I fight, not as one who beats the air. He hits the object he's hitting for. He uses the running metaphor and the fighting metaphor. And if you beat the air, your arms get tired when you miss. It's better to hit what you're aiming for in practice. That's what you have to do. Spiritual practice. Being prepared. Being ready. Just think. You never know when the Lord wants you to go to church and share the gospel with a visitor or someone else. I always think about that. A lot of people don't even think of that. What if God called on you to share the good news with somebody at church this morning? Think about that. Are you prepared? Are you ready? And that's what God wants us to be. And that's what Paul is dealing here. Because in chapter 3, verses 11 to 16, Paul, that's why he talks about becoming disqualified. Not losing his salvation, but becoming disqualified. And that Greek word is used for when you fail the test. We know our salvation is secured by Jesus Christ, so we can't lose it. But also that word is used about coins. Counterfeit coins. If you start preaching another gospel just to get numbers, and do preachers do that? Do churches do that? Do denominations do that? They surely do. That's how you become disqualified, because you can't change the message. You need to use gold, silver, and precious stones. But if you use wood, hay, and stubble, it will be burnt up. But your soul is still saved, because it's saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. Not what you have done, not what you're going to do, and how you do it. But the building materials are important, so you don't get disqualified. Personally and as a church. And that's what he's talking about. Enslaving yourself. What do they say? No pain, no gain. They don't apply that spiritually. I mean, what he's talking about here is self-discipline. Self-denial. Disciplining yourself spiritually and physically. The food at the table. Because Paul in chapter 10, he's going to talk about the spiritual drink, the spiritual food. In fact, it's rather appropriate that we're going to be in chapter 10 next week with the Olympics going on. Because they only eat certain things. There are a whole, I can guarantee you, these people in Korea, of all the teams, they're not going to be eating punch keys and drinking beer. Maybe at the end when it's all over and done with, they might. But as far as them competing, they've been practicing for years. And they're doing it for an imperishable crown. And what happens? The building materials are important. And as you enslave yourself, discipline yourself. I won't eat this. I won't drink that. I won't go here. Or I won't do that. That's what he's talking about. And being a servant to all. Being a servant to the people of the church. To your brothers and sisters. Then being a servant to the Jews, to the Gentiles, to the weak, to lost people. That's what he's talking about here, man. And notice the very last thing I put in there. No shortcuts. People are always trying to go to seminar one weekend, go to some 2 hours, and they feel they're going to get the Holy Ghost. And that's how these things where the people lay hands on them, they think they're going to get special intuition, special knowledge, and all of a sudden they're going to be powerful. I mean, in one sense, you wish it worked like that, but it doesn't work like that. The kingdom of God does not work that way. You have to deny self. Pick up your cross and follow me. That's how salvation works. That's how the kingdom of God works. That's why study. That's why it takes more than just studying the Bible. It's about opening your heart up to God and say, God, as the scripture says, do you want to be a servant to all? And God says, well, I want to send you here. Well, I don't think about it. I want to go there. Well, God knows that you don't want to be a servant to all, especially to Christ, to brothers and sisters, to the lost. The glory of God. That's what all this culminated to, for the glory of God. Not your glorification. And as people get this crossed up, and you can see it in churches today, people, their lives and attitude, it's for the glory of God, not for you. And that's why our prayers for the glory of God. That's why we pray, that's why we listen, for the glory of God. Being a servant to all. Because as I close, look at chapter 11. This is way down the line, verse 1. As he gets done at the end of chapter 10 with the food issue, he says, imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. That's what he's talking about. Paul's example. He's a servant to all. That's a great, he wants, and there's no, there will probably be only 1 or 2% of the Church of Corinth that's really grabbing hold of what Paul's saying. Because when you put me first, that has a tendency to blot out others, does it not? And it has a tendency to blot out God because you put yourself first. Remember, God first, others second. God will take care of you third. Joy, Jesus, others, and yourself. Imitate Paul. It's hard. Okay, it's hard. I've been trying to practice this, and I can do it sometimes, and it's just sometimes it's hard. See, you have to give up your rights. And we as Americans, we all have rights, don't we? We all have rights. But for the sake of the gospel, you got to give your rights up. That's how you become a servant to all. That's what Paul, that's what he's done. He has this right because he's done this individually. No one's done it to him. He's done it himself for the glory of God. What does God? For the gospel. To those lost Jews, lost Gentiles, to the weak. And then we love our brothers and sisters, being a servant to all. That means putting them first. And it is hard. So have you been imitating Paul in all these areas? It's hard. I guarantee you. I've had my shortcomings. It's hard. I'm working on it. I've been successful. I've been successful some of the time, but some of the times it just, boy, it comes at the wrong time. But when you make yourself a servant to all, as Paul did, Paul was ready. And I still remember what my Greek professor said in Greek class in the first week. He said, chance favors a prepared man. If you're not prepared, then whatever happens, the Lord brings your way, you will not be prepared. He was talking about tests and pop quizzes and Greek. How hard it is, hard. It was very difficult. We started out with 60 people in the class. By the end of the class, there was only 12 of us. People was falling left and right. It was remarkable. There was one week that 10, 12 people just failed. They couldn't handle it because it's a lot of memorization. People were falling left and right. Because they thought they were going to become great preachers, because if they know Greek, you've got to study Greek. You can't misuse it. See, that's why the building materials are so important. What you build with, for the glory of God, gold, silver, and precious stone, if you use that, when the fire comes, it will stand the test. But if you use wood, hay, and stubble, when the fire comes, you will have nothing. There are going to be a lot of people when they stand before the Lord that are Christians. But the wood, hay, and stubble, that vacuum sound has to be a fire blow. And I know that when the fire makes that noise, especially when it's going to be a big fire. That sucking sound makes a noise. That's what's going to happen to your works. And you have none. That'd be awful. But your soul saved because of the blood of Jesus. God expects you to be a servant to all. Let's all apply that to ourselves this morning. Let's bow our heads as we close in the word. Almighty God, we thank you for your faithful word, a word which is not only true thousands of years ago, but also in Paul's time, as we will learn from the history of the Bible, the people of the Bible, and as we learn from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Lord, cause us to be a servant to all, especially be a servant to Christ. Help us, Lord, put you first in our lives and our hearts. Help us, Lord Jesus, to put others, our brothers and sisters, and help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, to put lost people before ourselves, that we might be a witness to them, to those people, whether they be Jew, Gentile, or weak, they need Jesus Christ. Use us to be a witness, Lord. Teach us to help us to be a servant, as Paul was, in Jesus Christ. Amen. As we stand and as we sing,
56.
Number 56. We stand and sing. Can you be disciplined? Will you be a servant? It's all right. As we sing.
Yeah.
worship you. It is great to worship you because you are our glorious God, and so we give you the glory for all you enable us to do. And we realize that every breath we take, all our strength comes from you, our Almighty God. So we praise you this morning as we gather here together. We thank you for this time of fellowship. But even more, we thank you for Jesus who died for us. And we thank you for the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We pray and trust that we would be advised and led by him, and we would obey through him throughout this coming week. And we pray that even in this inclement weather, we would be safe because you are the great protector. So we worship you this morning. We pray for that we would worship throughout the week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You know, the Olsons were in Virginia now. Something has happened. They must not
need their visa.
Their visa. Something happened with their visa. So they're in Virginia right now. Yeah.